Beacon Press Audio presents Christians Against Christianity, How Right-Wing Evangelicals Are Destroying Our Nation and Our Faith, by Obery M. Hendricks Jr. This audiobook is narrated by Ron Butler. Published by Beacon Press Audio, 2021. He said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites. As it is written, this people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines. You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition." Mark chapter 7, verses 6 through 8. I was in hopes that the enlightened and liberal policy, which has marked the present age, would at least have reconciled Christians of every denomination so far that we should never again see the religious disputes carried to such a pitch as to endanger the peace of society. President George Washington, letter to Edward Newenham, October 20th, 1792. Introduction. A travesty. That's how I would characterize Christianity in America today. A travesty, a brutal sham, a tragic charade, a cynical deceit. Why? Because the loudest voices in American Christianity today, those of right-wing evangelicals, shamelessly spew a putrid stew of religious ignorance and political venom that is poisoning our society, making a mockery of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Their rhetoric in the name of their Lord and Savior is mean-spirited, divisive, appallingly devoid of love for their neighbors, and outright demonizes those who do not accept their narrow views, even fellow Christians. Perhaps most shocking is their enthusiastic, almost cultish support for the cruel, hateful policies and pronouncements of President Donald Trump, whose words and deeds more often than not have been the very antithesis of Christian faith. I do not make these claims lightly, and I can't be dismissed as a contentious outsider. I offer these observations as an ardent insider of the faith. I am a proudly ordained elder in the African Methodist Episcopal Church, a former president of its flagship theological seminary, and a dedicated biblical scholar trained at the highest levels of academia. But most significantly, I speak from a lineage of faithful Christians who know the gospel of Jesus Christ that right-wing evangelicals seem to have left behind. The gospel that tells us to love our neighbors, to respond to the cries of the poor and the vulnerable, to accept the immigrant stranger, to seek fairness and justice for all. Some might call me a progressive Christian, although I reject that and all other labels. I simply believe in the life-affirming, justice-insistent message that Jesus proclaimed and died for. I have little interest in the doctrinal bells and theological whistles that drive so much of Christendom today. You see, I am the product of two deeply religious families in rural Virginia, the place of my birth. From both, I have been gifted with a legacy of deeply devoted church pastors, trustees, deacons and deaconesses, Sunday school teachers, lifelong ushers, and gifted church musicians. My maternal grandparents loom particularly large in that blessed legacy. The loving, open-hearted generosity of my grandmother, Laura Banks, easily rivaled that of the Good Samaritan. She was a funny, kind soul, easy to laugh, whose love for her many grandchildren, it seemed to us at least, was second only to her love for her omnipresent God. Grandma began every day in the early morning dark, sometimes humming, sometimes singing, "Take my hand, precious Lord," she pronounced it "Pricious," as she prepared enough bacon, ham, salmon cakes, scrambled eggs, and buttered hoe cakes to feed the first three pews of her beloved St. Louis Baptist Church, which she attended in life and in which she was funeralized in death. Perhaps most impressive in spiritual temperament among my forebears was my beloved maternal grandfather, Joseph Baker Banks, a well-respected, mahogany-hued man of medium height, powerful build, proverbial quiet strength, loving demeanor, and unmistakable dignity. Although orphaned at the age of 12 and being raised in a fashion until his teens by his mother's white employer, he grew into a man well-respected by his community, a paragon of his Black Presbyterian church and a deeply devoted Christian gentleman in every sense of the word. He regularly led in solemn prayer my grandmother and their nine children, all of whom grew into good-hearted, upstanding citizens and faithful Christians, among them a pastor, two deacons, a pastor's wife, and assorted lay officers. Then there were my loving and devoted parents. My father, Obery Sr., was a trustee at Calvary Baptist, which had become our church home after he'd led my mother and me. My sister Linda did not grace the world until a couple of years later, on the off-trod road from the Jim Crow South to the somewhat less hostile racial environs of Newark, New Jersey, to settle in a three-room apartment at the end of an alley off a street that no longer exists. Then, as his fortunes rose, on to East Orange, a nice, contiguous sister city once voted the cleanest city in the nation, but which by then was on the fast track from a bedroom community of elegant shops and theaters to a struggling city that became known as the willing host to a gaggle of fast food restaurants and a bare-knuckled police force. A man fiercely proud of providing for his children and his stay-at-home wife, my father had bricklayer's hands so rough that you could strike a match on them. Yet his heart was nearly as tender as a saint's. My beautiful red-haired mother, Willie Beatrice, called Billy by family and friends, was a talented painter and sculptor and as religious as her siblings. For years, she made an art of sitting on church committees, both official and not, with very important-sounding names attached to less important missions, which were usually convened by older folks with little else to do. In her later years, my mother shifted into a higher spiritual gear that earned her the honorific of Mother of the Church, of which she was very proud until her dying breath. Although she was hard on me, her wayward son, to save me from falling into the eternal fires of hell and the earthly hell of prison, she was kind, witty, gracious, and uniformly described in death with the high compliment, "She was such a lady." For our part, my younger sister Linda and I regularly, and under considerable duress, performed the pew-sitting duty required by our church-possessed parents, which led us to wonder whether we had truly emerged from the womb in hospital delivery rooms, as we'd been told, or had instead entered the world in the Calvary Baptist Sunday School room in the presence of the loving, imperious church mother, Mrs. Gibson, and the other unexcited children she fussed at and fussed over weekly. There, for Sundays on end, we learned lessons that reside within us yet. It was there that we learned about the love of Jesus. It was there we were taught that other than the Son of Man, it is the loving unselfishness of the Good Samaritan that we should embrace and emulate. Our wonderful church family gifted us children with magnificent blessings that only became apparent as we ventured into the world. It was there, in the godly stronghold of Calvary Baptist Church, that we were treated as treasures from God. It was there that the church men, in their sober suits, and the church ladies, with their modest raiment and church hats perched like crowns, modeled for us the lessons of decorum, sobriety, and unflappable dignity that still run as deeply as marrow. These loving Christians worked hard to ensure that we felt our God-given worth in a society that did not fully value children like us. "No slouching," they admonished. "Stand tall and proud and act like somebody." Mumbling was unacceptable. We had to speak up and look the other firmly in the eye. With stories from the Bible, they alerted us to the deleterious seductions of the world, insisting that girls embody the carriage of dignified young ladies, and boys, the bearing of dignified young men. They celebrated our accomplishments, no matter how modest, with pride, encouragement, appreciative words, and dimes and quarters slipped with a wink into our eager little hands. From our parents and our church family, my sister and I learned that Christian living is synonymous with compassion. We were taught to pool our pennies to help families in need who, truth be told, were not much less well off than we. Synonymous with respect for proper authority, which held in its purview virtually every grown-up who was not vicious or creepy, and synonymous with honesty. I can still hear my mother admonish, "If you will lie, you will steal." We mourned with those who mourned and were taught to look beyond external differences to behold the humanity of all in God's household by welcoming strangers, no matter how ragtag, beaten by demon rum, or halting their English. Most of all, we were taught to love and to never hate. Not even the murderous faux Christians of the Ku Klux Klan, the embodiment of all things evil for every black person of sound mind. By word and deed, we were taught that there is no true love without the willingness to sacrifice for others, which was coupled with a stern insistence that all our dealings be fair and just. My sister and I never witnessed our parents taking unfair advantage or turning their backs to anyone who reached out in genuine need. In short, what I witnessed at home and at church was unstinting decency by people who would willfully hurt no one and would pray for anyone. Large-hearted folks who did their daily best to plant gardens of grace they nurtured with the nectar of goodwill, if not outright love. This is the faith to which I am heir. It is a faith that takes seriously the ethical demands of the gospel to love our neighbors as ourselves and to seek the salvation and well-being of the whole people, like the New Testament figure Simeon, who being righteous and devout, with the Holy Spirit rested upon him, prayed for the common good, the consolation or deliverance of his whole people from their travails at the hands of their Roman oppressors. Luke chapter 2, verse 25. But today, the contours of this faith.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.